Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your moderator, editor-at-chief at Bloomberg News, John Micklethwait.
Okay, so it's quite interesting.
Thank you very much. Yes, I am indeed John Micklethwait. The subject today is the global overview, the economic outlook. You've heard a variety of, you know, politicians arrive and explain why their country will grow amazingly fast or not. Now you get the truth from people who really know exactly what's happening in different places. To my right, there's Iswaran, Singapore's Minister for Trade and Industry, of Julie Katzman, of the Inter-American Development Bank, of David Zaslav of Discovery Communications, who's already getting clapped before he said anything. And we have Manny Roman, my old friend who now runs PIMCO. And I thought we will run through a variety of different topics, but I thought we could begin with trade, not least because we have a Minister for Trade and Industry beside us. And in terms of the worries that many of people here seem to feel about the economy, people come back and they say they like the idea of an American administration which is punchy on issues like tax reform and infrastructure, but they seem much more worried when it comes to areas like trade. Singapore is, by some measures, the most open economy in the world. How do you feel in this new environment where suddenly protectionism is on the rise?
So I think that's an important question. From our perspective, we are firm subscribers to free and fair trade. So I think, and that generally would be the guiding principle for any country. I think the real issue today...
That's odd though, isn't it? Because until recently we were all saying, when somebody said fair trade, people immediately thought that was protectionism.
Well, fair meaning, you know, it's a rules-based system, because if you look at the WTO and any other multilateral system, it is rules-based. So you want people to play by the rules, and that's what I think we mean by fair trade. I think the real issue today is we are conflating two sets of issues. One is around globalization and trade, and the other is the disruptions that are being caused by technology to business models, to jobs, and what they mean for economies and countries. And I think this is where the problem lies and concerns arise as well, because we really don't want many of the problems that arise from shifts in technology to be attributed to globalization and trade per se. So if you take Singapore, for example, in the manufacturing sector, manufacturing sector is growing. Last year, it grew at about 3% in real terms. But the employment declined by about 3 or 4%, precisely because of technological developments. And this is a trend that has been in place for quite some time. So I think the reality is we must expect that in an environment where technology is gathering pace, there's going to be a lot more disruption for businesses and jobs. So government's job, and I think policy focus, should not just be about the external-facing trade elements and the international engagement elements, but also complemented by domestic policy, which looks at how you can invest in the people from a training point of view, from an education point of view, so that they can adapt to the newer opportunities and trends, and also investing in the capabilities of businesses, especially the SMEs, because when you have international trade and globalization, there are bound to be some sectors that are at a disadvantage, relatively speaking, and others that benefit. And there is a need for complementary domestic policy.
Maybe if we can come back as a group, we can come back to this big issue of automation, of jobs changing in the way you've just described a bit later. But I wonder, Julie, if I can come to you for taking the position of Latin America, maybe. You look at things like the border adjustment tax. You look at these very political ideas. You know, how worried do you feel about those?
So worried enough to do some analysis.
that would be an improvement on
right. I'll double down on what Iswaran said, which is there's a university that did an analysis of the 5+ million jobs that were lost in the U.S. between 2000 and 2010, and said that 85% of them were lost due to technology, not due to trade. So that kind of tells you that maybe we have a diagnosis problem on all of that, but. Clearly, Latin America is a region that depends on trade for a great deal of its GDP. And So what happens if there's a border tax or any other kind of tariff measure that really restricts trade? And what's interesting is that Latin America, because it's had a really good trading relationship with the U.S. historically, and now with the U.S. and with China, it actually did a lot less trade within the bloc. So intra-Latin American trade is only about 20% of trade, compared to 60% in the EU or 50% in the Pacific and Asia. So what we've done is to say, well, what would happen if there was a border tax or something of similar import, like any other kind of tariff? If you increase the amount of intra-group trade, how does that help you? And you can decrease the impact of that border tax by 50% if you increase your intra-group trade. And so we've looked at, basically, there are only a couple of pieces missing within Latin America to make the trading much more fluid. Mexico needs to have an agreement with Brazil, which it doesn't have today. The Pacific Alliance countries with Mercosur. And then the ability to trade within the group goes up dramatically and lets you offset
the impact. Doesn't it feel odd, though, that you now have Latin America used to be always this place that America would come and lecture about the need to open up economies, to not have tariff barriers, and now there is a message, at least for north of the border, that that is changing?
It does feel odd, and I will tell you that both at the IMF World Bank meetings a week ago and at our own annual meeting with the 48 countries who are shareholders of the IDB, the theme that everybody expressed, all the finance ministers, was there's no question in our minds that this is the way to a more prosperous world. And that, like Iswaran said, we have to manage the temporal dislocations of the losers and make more people winners. And I think that that's really where efforts have to go. And in Latin America, the view is, how do we make trade more inclusive? How do we get more SMEs in that trade cycle?
Manny, maybe we can bring you in. You're somebody who sits there and directs a great deal of investment. How much do you worry about trade as an issue?
We do worry. I mean, if we, you know, we heard Secretary Mnuchin talking about his tax package. The number we think in terms of deficit over the next, 10 years is around $5 trillion, and so you need to fund this. And, you know, economic theory will tell you that there's many ways to fund it. It can be future growth, in which case, if growth goes from 2.5% to 3%, there'll be more tax receipt. That's a tall order. Then the other way to fund it is obviously through border adjustment tax. We don't think this is a good thing or the way the Trump administration is going to go, but one or two things will happen. Either the tax package will have to be modified in the House, in which case the growth expectation will be smaller, which is our current thinking given what we know, or that there will be a need to fund it, and the funding is unfortunately coming from different places, and one of them could be border adjustment tax. But once again, we think the former scenario is more likely than the latter scenario.
But you know, you probably have more treasury bonds than anyone apart from the government of China. When you look at the US position, does the idea of there being this hole in the budget because of the lack of a border adjustment tax, does that worry you more than the effects of protectionism through having that tax?
I don't think the market is overly worried. I think what the market is telling you is that we have low rates. And why do we have low rates? Because the market, the treasury market, tells you that growth is going to be 2.5%, and the tax package will either need to be rehashed in the House and recut in the House, or growth won't happen. And that's why rates are 2.3%. I think that's the sad reality of the bond market.
But can I just jump in here for a second to say, it just seems like an odd conversation that we're talking about what would be a huge change in global policy as a way to balance the tax bill, right? I mean, that just seems odd, no?
Minister, do you want to comment on that quickly before we come back to David? But what's?
Well, I think fiscal policy.
You cannot sit there from Singapore, the home of free trade, and a minister for trade, and claim you think this is a wonderful idea.
I think we have to each work out our own solutions. But having said that, I think it's not about a quick fiscal fix, because there are some, I think, very profound fundamental shifts taking place, and that's why I made the point earlier. I think if you'd misdiagnose the issue, and then you will get the wrong solution.
And so it's not just about the trade elements. And I think addressing some of the fiscal imbalance, you'll have to look at other solutions. But I think fundamentally, the domestic policy aspect has to focus on capacity building, which I think is an area which I've not heard a great deal on. But capacity building, and you know, it goes to the earlier point on inclusive growth. Whether it is about individuals in sectors or in geographies who are displaced from their jobs, or companies that find themselves now at a competitive disadvantage, I think you need capacity development and growth and investment in that. And that's going to be a key part of any country strategy. And it's not just about fiscal policy, not just about trade policy, and I think you have to look at it holistically. And that's where I leave it. You know, in a place like Singapore, we have our challenges too, because we're a small open economy. Trade is three times our GDP. One-third of our workforce is from overseas. And we believe in staying open as an economy, but it does pose adjustment problems for us as well. But it's an ongoing effort to continually reinvent and reinvest in the training of our people, in education of our people, and in the capabilities of our businesses.
David, maybe I can bring you in as the purest businessman on this panel. Discovery, I checked, over half your revenue, I think, comes from outside America. How do you feel about this sort of worry, which we've been discussing, of a slightly less global world?
Yeah, from an international perspective, we're about 63% of our revenue comes from outside the U.S. And the stability of the U.S. and our openness to doing business around the world has really been a boon to people in my business. Our product is IP. And so we've been moving our content, our IP, on all devices. We have an average of 12 channels in 230 countries. So we really do have a bird's eye view of what's going on in every economy around the world, because we get to see how the advertising market is doing. We're also in the business of selling to distributors, so we get to see what's going on with the cellular and mobile players, as well as the cable operators. And you know, there are times when what happens politically here has an impact. You know, we had a very big business in Russia, and as Putin changed his political positioning, within a week, no media company could own more than 20% of a media asset in Russia. And so it created a lot of instability. So I think the idea that there's kind of open borders for IP right now, we take for granted. We built quite a big business on that. And we're invited in almost everywhere in the world, partly because our content is so non-controversial, but also as a U.S. company, we're viewed in a very favorable way and we're given a positive chance. I thought, in the context of getting a sense of our perspective, to give you to do a short tape on who Discovery is.
There's a video, I think, which is going to appear.
Four, three, two, one, and liftoff.
30 years pushing the limits of what's possible has shown that the power of discovery defies even our wildest imagination. From a single nonfiction network to the global leader in premium entertainment, reaching 3 billion viewers worldwide with sports, kids, documentaries, and the number one network for African American viewers. From TV to digital to mobile, serving billions of streams to millions of superfans through Group 9. A global leader in digital entertainment. And now Europe's home for the Olympic Games for the next decade. Today and in the future, we will continue to push boundaries and see from a new perspective. But our mission remains the same: to empower and celebrate, to explore and delight on any screen at any time. Because we know when it comes to what's possible, there is no limit to discovery.
There may be no limit to discovery, but there might just conceivably be one from regulators and from governments trying to stop you. where exactly do you, in terms of growth going forward, where exactly do you see that coming from?
Well, growth is really the challenge. I think that it's the challenge that this whole conference is about. If you take a look across Europe, where we have Eurosport and free to air channels and about 10 cable channels in every country, over the last 15 years, the GDP in the aggregate has been zero. And our growth comes from generally advertising revenue that goes along with GDP. And we've been able to get double-digit growth around the world, including Latin America, when we get market share growth. So you're really, market share growth is the hardest thing to get because you're really, it's hand-to-hand combat. So the challenge that you see politically because of limited growth around the world is presenting real challenges to our business. The good news is that people are consuming more content than they ever have, and they want to consume it on more devices, so the demand is there. But the lack of growth around the world is probably the biggest issue. And we had a lot of growth in Brazil and Mexico, and up until 2 years ago, it really felt like the currents were with us. But
I was going to ask all of you this, but what indicators do you look for when you're looking for growth? What are the things you follow? You mentioned advertising revenue. Is that the main one? Or what is, when you're looking at economic growth, yeah, particularly?
You know, if you look at GDP over the last 30 years, it correlates, you know, quite well to advertising growth, and really with a very small standard deviation. The other thing we can look at is subscribers. For instance, Brazil, we were very successful in Brazil with what you call here in the U.S. a skinny bundle. Most of Brazil was penetrated. It got to about 18% penetration of the wealthy. And they put together the equivalent of a $10 package to try and grab the C-class. And for the last 5 years or so, it's been 90% of the growth came from that. And it was enormous. This past year and a half, Brazil saw two million subscribers lost. And Mexico was growing better than double digit. This year it's growing low to mid single. And so subscriber growth in countries that aren't highly penetrated is an indication of that GDP issue of, do people have this disposable income?
Manny, maybe I can bring you in. Sure. When you look at economic growth, you look at America at the moment, confidence is up, but spending is weak. You have business claiming to be optimistic, but not spending that much either, not investing that much. What signals for this audience here, what signals do you look at to try and detect how fast growth is going to be?
So I think the current view is that we're going to grow in the US at 2.5%. And I guess to go from 2.5% to 3%, which would be a good result, is that animal spirit take over, capex goes up, and that money is deployed quickly in infrastructure. And so take the former, we will look at company and their ability to put money to work and to invest quickly. And I think that the soft data so far tend to converge toward the hard data. People haven't pulled the trigger. It's obviously very hard to gauge, and a lot of it is based on investment project and what you see happening. In terms of the latter and what can happen, we will look at every single credit card and consumer behavior in terms of what customer and what consumer can do and whether there's a pickup in demand and what happened. The labor market looks incredibly robust, although you see labor participation going up. And I think one of the things that the minister just mentioned is that obviously between automation and between participation in the labor force, one of the things which is surprising is how little wage inflation you have in the US. So you have potentially also a situation where a pickup in growth wouldn't translate into additional inflation.
But do you worry that there is something in the secular stagnation argument that basically, notwithstanding everything, notwithstanding all the things that this particular administration wants to do, it is going to be difficult to grow the American economy or any Western economy more than, say, 2.5%?
There is an open question in terms of macroeconomic policy and how effective tax policies are in terms of long-term productivity. And just to quote the Stanford economist John Cochrane, he basically says that, you know, tax policy is an espresso shot. You know, it wakes you up, but it doesn't long-term change your sleep pattern. If you need to stay awake, you need to find other ways to do it. And I think the structural issues in terms of productivity and higher growth are very structural and are not based on tax policies, although tax policy obviously helps.
Now, are you more optimistic about America still than Europe, or do you think Europe can now catch up?
I think there would be a consensus across everyone in this room that the US growth number are at least 1% better than the European numbers. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the reasons, and please have anyone disagree with me, is that the labor market in half of Europe is so structurally impaired mm-hmm. in terms of labor law that wage adjustment just doesn't work. And I come from a country which is well-placed to make this kind of comment.
And do you place Britain in the European end or the American end?
Well, you decided to exit, if I... But no, I don't put you in there. Although I know you agree with me and that it was a terrible idea.
Just to come back to, I'm going to come on to the Minister and Julian in a second, but if that's your outlook on the developed world, how do you look at the developing world? I mean, how do you look at the emerging markets? Do you see that as a place where there is going to be a much higher speed limit still, Manny?
I think emerging market is obviously quite a big area of the world, but you have higher growth in emerging market, and I think from a positioning standpoint, do I think that, you know, emerging market bond in local currency will tend to do better than developed bond? Absolutely. And so that tells you something about the state of the world and the fact that there's been a global shift in terms of productivity and in the fact that you've had higher returns in emerging market. Now, what is the challenge? The challenge is you have a complicated political situation, at least in Brazil and in Mexico, where you have elections coming. But you have clearly good news in Argentina, where the situation becomes better. You have good news in Colombia. You have good news in Chile, although there's an election coming. And then you clearly have good news in Asia. And I think one of the things which was one of the risks a year ago is China seems to be in absolutely fine shape. Mm-hmm. And the 6.5% we have for China seems to be very robust.
Maybe we go through those two. Should we come to you first, Julie, on the Latin American side? Do you agree with that picture? And how worried are you about the sluggishness of Brazil?
So I think if you're in Brazil over the last few weeks, most of the private sector would say they feel like they've reached the bottom and that things are beginning to turn. Some of the major auto companies have had in March the first positive year-on-year comparison in a long time. So, you know, I think that sentiment is probably there, and we project that Brazil will have some growth in 2017, obviously off a much lower base after negative 3% for, you know, a couple of years. You know, Brazil's economy is so big that when you look at numbers for Latin America as a whole, they dwarf the rest of the region, but Central America has been growing at 4% a year over the last few years. Peru, Colombia, 3-4%, Mexico, 2-3%. So there's been a not bad story, but by the same token, big productivity challenges, right? Underinvestment in infrastructure that now governments are trying to address, largely through public-private partnerships, and big underinvestment or need for better investment, I should say, in human capital, right? The other side of that productivity challenge. And, you know, I think the region has been focused on the fact of how unequal it has been over time and is really trying to think about how the benefits of growth and trade are invested so that those benefits are more equally shared and drive more growth. Because if you don't have capacity in your human capital, then you won't have growth in the future.
Do you think a huge amount of Brazil's commodity boom was wasted?
I think a huge amount of everybody's commodity boom was not invested that well. And I should say, though, a lot of it was invested well. I mean, if 100 million people left poverty and joined the middle class, okay, that there were some really good investments there. And more kids are in school, and better health care was delivered, no question. But the quality of education is probably the biggest thing that has not been addressed well enough. And that's where the investments either weren't made or weren't made optimally. And I think every country in the world has problems addressing the kind of structural reforms you have to make your education system work, and Latin America is no different. But it's a really important thing to hit next. One in three kids doesn't graduate from high school.
But sorry to interrupt, but one of the things which matters is the rule of law. And I think Brazil, the problem for investors like us, is it's great to invest, but it's even better if we get our money back. And if we get a fair.
No question. And it doesn't, and I skipped over the political question as well, right? What is the next? This is not only the couple of countries that Manny mentioned, but it's a very busy next 12 months in elections in the region.
The one area that you see significant investment around the world, which is a great piggyback for us, is the investment in broadband. And it can address a lot of these issues. But the one thing about broadband that's multi-channel cable is something that people love. And if they can afford it, it's always been one of the first things they'll get. And it's still a very strong business for us all over the world. But people will pay for broadband before they pay for dinner. And so this is a product that's extraordinarily powerful. And you see the growth in broadband all over the world. If you look at what Malone did with Liberty Global, he really bought cable systems around Europe that really weren't pricing in the value of broadband. And he and Mike Fries have had a tremendous run-up. And as you look across all of Europe and Latin America, there's huge investment going into who is going to own the pipe to the home, the broadband, the multi-channel, and the phone. And it's going to be one person. And as long as that investment continues and people are spending more and more time on broadband and on their phones, that's great for us. And what we're starting to see is that once all that investment is made and you stop someone and you say, who's your carrier? Who do you use for your phone, or who do you use for your broadband? Very, very rarely do they know. It's just a pipe. You know, not to be pejorative, but it's sort of a dumb pipe. And so there's now a turn where all of those providers of distribution are looking for IP to differentiate. So whether it's BT in the UK that's buying football, or Deutsche Telekom that's looking at special IP, it's one of the reasons why we as a company pivoted and got into sports in Europe and invested billions in sports. And all the content that we own on all devices. And so our bet is that we can continue to have a nice growth business based on our 12 or 13 channels and free-to-air channels that go through to the TV set. But the fact that we could then sell that content again to Verizon or AT&T or Deutsche Telekom or BT. So when we look at content now, we don't say what content do we need just for the TV screen. We say what content do we need for all screens, because there's over 7 billion screens right now around the world, and those are in people's hands.
Do you have any kind of comparison between, on the conversation we were having about the comparison between different emerging markets, do you have any kind of comparison between the way you look at Latin America and the way you look at Asia?
Well, there's a number of markets in Asia that are just, they're never getting to the wired home. So if you look at Malaysia or Indonesia or a lot of areas of Vietnam or a lot of areas of Africa, we're going directly over broadband or directly to mobile. Because that infrastructure is just not being built. And it's tricky. It's tricky because, you know, early stage, you think all content is going to work on all platforms, but it doesn't. You know, we bought in the last year a business called Group 9. It's actually four businesses we put together. It does about 4 billion views a month, and we're the leader of news on Facebook. But it's one-minute stories with text, and you don't need to listen to it. And we had to buy that because that's, you know, even though we're a 30-year company in storytelling, we didn't know how to tell stories for Facebook or Snapchat. We had to buy that competency of people that knew how to tell stories differently.
Minister, may I come back to you? We've had this kind of story from Latin America with the brief deviation. How do you see Asia at the moment? Do you see Asia as part still the fastest growing bit of the emerging economies, slightly as Manny was hinting?
Well, I think first, if you look at it from a general macroeconomic growth potential point of view, essentially it's a function of your labor force growth and your productivity. And what impairs your performance relative to that is really rules in the marketplace, or whether it's your rule of law or labor market rigidities. And on the other hand, you can try and raise the productivity potential by investing in people, investing in innovation, and creating new technology possibilities. So I look at it, I mean, if you look at Asia today, China is doing its 6% or so growth. India is doing about 7. In ASEAN, you're looking at about 5 to 5.5, and that's likely to persist at least the end of this decade and potentially longer. And in all these economies, and in particular in, say, in ASEAN and India, there's a demographic dividend, and then you're seeing, and I think the point on the leapfrogging of technology going into mobile is very significant in many of these markets. And therefore, the technology is enabling a new kind of digitalized economy, or a digital economy as well, which I think is going to unleash new growth potential. So that's one thing I wanted to say, that apart from the fact that in absolute terms, Asia is already seeing growth, which is relatively high compared to other regions, I think the potential is being enhanced through the digital economy. And the other aspect of it, which I think is going to drive, is also how the Asian economies work together. And we're seeing a lot of intra-Asia trade and intra-Asia cooperation because of the complementary needs in many instances. So my own sense of it is the prospects are significant. There are going to be significant regional variations. You can't look at China as one monolithic mass. There are going to be regional and city-level variations. And I think the same would apply easily to Indonesia, to other ASEAN countries, and certainly India as well. But the key point is, in aggregate, the potential is significant. There are efforts being made at the central and many regional levels to unlock or remove some of the impediments to growth. And I think there's scope for private sector investment working in tandem with governments. Of course, the rules and some of the uncertainties are things that are continually worked on. For example, within ASEAN, that's what we try and do.
And what do you think the main barrier, the main risk is to that rather healthy picture?
Well, I suppose there's always the cycle risks, which everybody tends to work with and so on. I think the other major element for us would really be how well the economies of Asia or subcomponents. I mean, there's a political risk factor that has to be factored in, but it's also how they're able to make the transition. Because in many of the verticals in the economies, the challenge is that the technological disruption is changing the modality. So in India, for example, they have a Make in India initiative because they expect it to generate many jobs. The reality is manufacturing is not going to be the same kind of job-creating engine that it was in the past. And the type of skills needed for new manufacturing, especially if it's export-oriented, is also very different. So I think understanding the transitions and having the infrastructure and the capabilities that support that is going to be a major differentiating factor, apart from the usual political risk type of issues.
Do you expect India to grow faster than China?
Well, that's what the rate is at this point.
Yes.
But I think it's, it's a kind of difficult question because, China has been at these sorts of growth levels and higher for at least a couple of decades now. India is in a relatively more recent entrant. By some calculations, they would say India is at about where China was maybe about 15 years ago or 20 years ago. So the potential, I think, for India's growth is significant. But again, I think there are rigidities and impediments in the markets that have to be overcome. And one of the recent initiatives in India was the move on the goods and services tax, which at least tries to even out the domestic space, and you don't have to worry about movement of goods across state borders in India, which in itself was a major hindrance to trade and movement of goods.
Manny, are you optimistic about Asia, about India in the same way?
Yes, there's a great opportunity. You know, the frustrating thing for people like us is we would like to be able to participate in a domestic market, which is not that straightforward. Mm. But we believe in the India growth story, and I would very much agree with the minister that growth in India looks pretty steady for the years to come.
And I think the potential, for example, the Indian government has launched an infrastructure fund. The question is whether there are ways to create opportunities for international investors to come in.
To come, that's right.
And whether it all has to be rupee-denominated or it can also have a dollar-denominated component. And these are ideas we've also suggested to the Indian government to consider, so that there are ways for investors to, in some ways, hedge their currency exposure whilst participating in the growth opportunities.
Do you worry at all that the lack of integration you talked about earlier is going to get in the way? I saw that Singapore is one of those countries which has joined China's infrastructure bank, the investment bank, Asian investment bank, to the slight chagrin of the, to use a French word, of the Americans.
No, I think, we are involved in the AIIB, just as we are involved in the World Bank, just as we have involved with the ADB in different ways. I think these are efforts to invest in infrastructure. And to the extent that the AIIB, which is also, you know, it's linked to the Chinese One Belt, One Road initiative, and to the extent that it actually allows for significant and systematic investment in infrastructure across Asia, I think it's going to have a very benign and positive impact on Asia's growth potential. I think we should not be looking at, because the Japanese are also involved through ADB and other mechanisms. So, and the World Bank is very active in Asia as well. So I think it's a good dynamic where you've got multiple parties involved, and I think there's scope for the private sector to also be engaged, because the opportunity is clear and present. It's just a question of how you structure these deals so that more private sector funding can be channeled towards this. Because I think if you just rely on public sector capital, it's going to be difficult.
There's one common theme you've all mentioned repeatedly, technology and the effects of it. Do you see, and there's been a mixture, sometimes you talked about technology in a benign way as something that opens up economies, David particularly, yeah. But a number of different times, the rest of you have also talked about technology as a thing that removes jobs, especially in the West, yeah. Or challenges it. Is that the real problem that we see in terms of the reaction, the interaction between politics and the economy over the next few years?
So I think that's a very real problem. If you look at, say, technology like robotics and automation, the big fear amongst the workforce is, if I'm displaced by a robot or some machine, what's the next option for me? I think if you look around the world in general, and I've looked at this, you know, when you look at IIoT, Industrial Internet of Things, and robotics in Germany and in many other parts of the world, there are opportunities to create, there are new opportunities being created, even as you introduce robotics. And it's not uncommon in history to have fears arising from technological change, but I'm quite optimistic you can create jobs. But the real challenge is finding ways to bridge people into these jobs, because they may not necessarily have the skill sets, and the people who are displaced may not necessarily be the ones who are most equipped to take on these new jobs. So that's why the domestic policy element and looking for, because a lot of other kinds of jobs in the services sector are being created as well in these economies. So there can be transitions, may not always be in the same sector, but across sectors. The other sort of powerful enabling aspect of technology is the digital economy. And I wanted to emphasize that, because when you're talking about inclusive growth, a big aspect of it is how it empowers the small and medium-sized enterprise. And when you look at that, in terms of market access, in terms of B2B collaborations, in terms of finding new ways to enhance your business operations, I think the digital economy offers significant upside potential for small and medium-sized businesses. So from that perspective, I think it's a very positive influence, and we just have to manage the downsides, especially when we're talking about jobs.
Do you agree with that, Julie?
I do. I think, you know, there was an interview earlier today that Eric Schmidt did, and I think in many ways it's a lack of our own ability to have our imagination run free on what new jobs will be created, but we're really good at figuring out which jobs will be lost.
Yes.
So we tend to see the glass as half empty. But as Iswaran was just saying, you have to have a workforce that's well enough trained that they can participate in that new economy. And that's why I think investment in educational systems and increasing the quality, and this is true across probably the entire planet, but specifically across in the developing world, becomes so important. So, you know, that everybody talks about the aging of the US and in Europe, and I think the number is that something like 20% of China's workforce will have retired, be missing in by 2030, 2050. Latin America's on the other end of that, like a lot of Africa. There's a huge bulge of youth. But right now, 20% of 15 to 24-year-olds neither go to school nor work. Right? So what do you do with that group of people 10 years from now when the jobs that are available are ones that require real skills? And so, you know, to turn that into a positive really requires good policy at the front end to create good educational systems and good training opportunities. And the Germans clearly are really good at this, and we're trying to learn from the Germans in Latin America and involving them in thinking about how you do better with training and apprenticeship and that kind of thing.
David, in our industry, the media industry, there's a famous line, I think, that journalists love. They're all in favor of free trade and all in favor of technology, except when it happens to them. How do you, if you look and see at the way that discovery is going, you might get a lot of growth, but does that mean you're going to be employing more people going forward, or is this the technology you're bringing in? Is that fundamentally things that is about replacing people?
Well, it requires that we do business differently, really. That look, the old way was terrifically attractive. You'd go into a country, there's 50 channels, we have 12 of them. The only way you consume content is on your TV set, and we have ownership of it. And so when you click along, you know you're going to get us. With this transition to broadband and more content being consumed on the phone, the question is, what are people going to watch when they could watch anything? So it's required us to really change our philosophy and get better. And so what we've done is we've taken an optimistic view of this, and we'll see if we're right, that we're larger than Disney in Brazil with our kids business. We have a very big kids business in Latin America. We bought a lot more kids IP because we think that will be something that people will be buying for their kids on their phones and on all devices. So we started to look, the prism changed. What content can we have that people would pay for or that they feel like they would have to have on their phone? And so that's why we went into sports, that's why we went into kids, that's why we really tightened up the Oprah Winfrey Network into a superfan network of African-American women. We have a channel ID that's a superfan network for number one in America for women, and we're taking it around the world. But it is scalable because, you know, if we have science content, and that science content is already in 52 languages, you know, we could create a science app for $2.99 and we could make it available everywhere in the world. We're building now, we're offering our sports content direct to consumer for a fee. It's a sports Netflix. So Netflix was a disruptor by going around the middleman, the cable operator or the satellite provider, and they were richly rewarded with a huge multiple by going direct to consumer. And so for us, we said, we want to continue to do what we're doing, traditional television on the TV set, because it's still a great business. But we have to build a direct relationship with the customer outside of that. And we thought our best way to do that is with these super fan niches, whether it be sports or Oprah or science or crime. And we're doing quite well with it. It's not mature yet, but we could build that business.
But that could be a very good argument. And me as a consumer of some of your products, especially the football ones, I'm very happy. But does that necessarily mean you employ more people? It could be that you're displacing, when you buy up all the global rights to children's things, that is actually displacing local people who were making children's bits in different areas.
Well, you know, yes and no. What we're doing is, because we're chasing a new business, we we hired a load of people in, we have a big business now in the UK that's a direct-to-consumer business. Mm-hmm. We were never in the direct-to-consumer business. We were in the B2B business. We sold our content to the satellite providers and the cable operators. So we didn't know how to reduce churn. We didn't have anyone collecting credit cards. We didn't know how to directly do business with customers. And so we've hired a lot of people, and in buying more kids' IP and buying more African-American IP and more Hispanic IP, we're employing more people to produce content, but we're also buying more content from production companies in order to nourish these baskets. And so, you know, in the end, I think that the robustness of the media businesses will be quite strong, as will the employment in the business. The question is, will the business models for... We know that in the dual revenue stream cable business, our margins are in the high 30s, early low 40s, and it's a hell of a business. How good of a business is, you know, we do 4 billion streams a month on Facebook, but we don't make money. So the right now we're trying to get scale in every demographic, and we're trying to have people spend time with all of our brands. But the challenge for some of these is, you know, is the economic model sustainable? Right now, we have a lot of people paying for our content, but not enough for it to be a very big business. You know, even Netflix, it trades at a very high multiple because it really doesn't make much money yet.
The trouble with this NIMBY thinking,
yes,
not in my backyard, which is what you just talked about, is that I think somebody else will do it, and then you won't have a backyard. Yes. So you may as well start thinking ahead and seeing how you can adjust to it. And I think that's the challenge, though, because the inertia to change is so difficult.
Manny, can you comment quickly on your business, which is one where computers would seem to be taking over a lot? And then secondly, maybe just introduce the issue of inequality from your perspective.
Yes, I mean, I have to say I struggle a little with the argument. I think the data in the U.S. show that there will be a significant number of jobs being lost over the next 20 years to automation. And for all the obvious reasons we've been talking about, and I think this trend, I see no sign of any of the trend to slow down. Now the question is, what kind of jobs will be created? If you look at the data in the US, there's been many jobs created in services. Is there a causality link? Not obvious. Not obvious at all. All we know is at the same time jobs have been lost in manufacturing and jobs have been created in services, but there's no obvious reason why the creation of jobs was that obvious. And so, what I do think is that the mismatch in terms of education level, in terms of creating these new jobs, are a real challenge for all of the Western economies. How to basically give the right skills to a whole new generation of young people to be able to face a world where service may not be where the jobs are. You know, at the end of the day, if you and I go and have a coffee at Starbucks and we have to push a button, and we get our almond latte, it may be okay. And it may be that it's the way of the future, and it may be much more efficient. And I think these things are a struggle to think about in terms of how jobs will be created and the value of these jobs, because the machine is actually very efficient.
The almond latte fallacy.
So when you think of the last time that there was this big technological revolution at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, that's when in the United States, the law became that you had to stay in school till you were 16. Public education for high school began at that moment, and it was the same challenge, right? It was clear that a different kind of skills and a different skill set would be required and a higher level of skill set. And so I think in many ways, that's where we are today, right? We can see it. And we know what the solution actually is. So how do we get to that solution?
Surely it's much more difficult. Back then, when the Industrial Revolution happened, you were taking people from the agriculture, from the fields, and you were giving them a basic primary education so they could go into factories. If you're talking about jumping from manufacturing or very basic services, as Manny is, towards the sort of jobs where you need to understand AI, you need to be able to do some of the things David's talking about, that involves graduate, maybe even postgraduate stuff.
It is, except those same leaps forward are happening within the machine learning industry. So most who are in that would say that shortly, you won't need to be a programmer. Computers will understand natural language. you'll be able to interact with that computer to say, I want you to create an app that lets me hail a taxi, not I have to code to do that. And so, you know, that's why I say the limit in some ways is our imagination, because we all think very linearly. And if you actually talk to the guys who are the AI guys and the machine learning guys, I think they're much more optimistic in many ways because they can see the step beyond the step. And, you know, a lot of those skills are not that hard to learn if you've got the right systems in place.
Just to play devil's advocate, you look back at the Industrial Revolution, and the other really obvious thing is it took time. People left the fields, and jobs got lost in vast amounts. But it took time for the jobs to appear in the factories, and out of that, you've got a huge amount of political dislocation. This time, do you face the same thing?
Without a doubt, we're already seeing that, right? And that's why I think what Iswaran said about you have to at least get the diagnosis right, so you might match up the prescription with the diagnosis. There's no question that there's periods of time that make this really difficult. And if you're not there with policies that kind of help manage those dislocations, then political unrest is what happened last time and likely to happen in the future. And I just say, I think that the point that Iswaran was making about how digital can empower, you know, we created a tool that is called Connect Americas, that is a digital platform for small and medium-sized enterprises to engage in international trade where they couldn't before. And now you add into that natural language capability so that people can communicate with each other independent of the fact that they don't have a common language, you create new kinds of opportunities. And we're going to have to look for all of those kinds of things.
But when you think about all this discussion, the practical reality is that there's virtually, outside of the U.S., which is small, if you look in Latin America, you look in Europe, there's virtually no growth. And the last time we saw 10 to 15 years of zero GDP growth, wages are down, significant youth unemployment, was in the 20s and 30s. And, you know, there's a certain thing about human beings where, you know, we're hopeful. But when you get to a decade where your wages are down, you have significant unemployment, and there's no sign of real growth, you start to see, you know, breakage at the seams. And that's what you're seeing across Europe. And it seems to be there's no break toward the middle. The break is to the right, or the break is hard left to socialism. So, you know, if you really look around at what's going on, you know, it's quite scary. And it also, you also see the rise in all kinds of hate, which is also reminiscent of that same time. And it's reminiscent of kind of the human condition, that there's only so long that we could be living without positive change, without feeling we need political change, and it's somebody else's fault. And so, you know, we see it in Europe, we see it in Latin America. It's a challenge, and it's a challenge that we're going to have to address because Europe, in some cases, looks pretty scary politically.
Nowhere looks more scary than France. Manny, you can apply that rather bleak vision to France. Do you think that is a place? You talked earlier about Europe being a place where labor markets were sclerotic. Is that the kind
of... I'll give you the 20 seconds background in terms of where I come from. I come from Alsace. 19th century, we produce cotton. We're doing great. The Civil War is very good for Alsace because the South stopped exporting cotton to the West. And then India hasn't picked up the slack demand in terms of manufacturing cotton. And so, very good. And then, obviously, after the 20th century, cotton is produced everywhere but in Europe. And then what do you have? You have part two, which is the car manufacturing save my region, which is right next to Germany. And now car manufacturing is not being done in France because it's too expensive, and so the factory closes. And then you have a population which is unemployed, who refuse to move for all sorts of good reason, and 30 or 35% of them vote for Madame Le Pen, which is a terrible situation.
And do you think
and that in 200 years gets you from a place buoyant with energy and buoyant with innovation to a place where the only thing you will know about Alsace is that there's a great road with a lot of delicious white wine.
And if you were another book-loving Frenchman called Emmanuel and you were about to become president of France, what would you do to change that?
You have to reform labor laws. You have to take the hard pill, and the hard pill is that whether you like it or not, it's a global economy, and that globalization has made a lot of other countries incredibly competitive. And it's more than time to swallow the pill and break the 35 hours law and give flexibility in the labor market. And there's no other way.
Minister, you are, for people who look for hope against this horizon, many people, when they think about government efficiency, Singapore is often cited as the place which has been most able to move with change. What lessons do you have for the West, which may in this case be following you?
Well, I think we don't pretend that what works for us will work necessarily for everybody else. But I think the most important element is, first, I think long before lack of opportunity, I think it's going to be skills mismatch or lack of the appropriate skills that's going to be the cause of a lot of inequality. I think, you know, because there's a lot of concern about, are there going to be enough job opportunities? But the sense, you know, when you look at many areas, you know, the opportunities tend to manifest themselves in different ways. But we need to be able to create that, a pathway for people to absorb it. Take, for example, today, globally, there's a shortage of people for cybersecurity and data analytics work. And yet, this is an area where you can work with people who are in adjacent sectors, those who are mildly quantitative or inclined in that way, and they can be trained in a modular way, in an incremental way, and to adapt into this. And there are, you know, even in these sectors, there are gradations of jobs. You don't have to be a hotshot cybersecurity expert, but you can do a lot of other work that supports that hierarchy. So my sense of it is it needs hard work, because you need to really roll up your sleeves, do the analysis, and say, where are the opportunities, how are they being created, and what sort of skill sets are needed, and then governments have to get involved. It's a lot easier, I would say, when you're a smaller economy like Singapore. You know, we can put our arms around the problem and really sit down and work at it. It's probably a little bit more challenging when you're a very large economy with, you know, millions entering the workforce every year. But I think a good place to start is really just remove the rigidities and start, because once you remove the rigidities, people will start responding. And I think that will be a good way to get things going, and then invest in skills.
And in terms of government involvement, one of the things that stands out about Singapore is that actually they pay their government ministers more, they give, maybe even you, they pay bureaucrats more, they take an interest in government. Government seems to be the great forgotten subject in the West. Do you think that is something that is coming back?
All the conversations in Singapore end up on the pay of the civil servants and politicians. I know. Anyway, but I will make one point about this, which I firmly believe in, and I think it's something that we all need, you know, and it's something that from the time of Singapore's independence has been a major consideration, which is we often talk about the capacity of the private sector, the capabilities of the people, the skills, the businesses and their competence and so on. The reality is you also have to make sure you've got public sector capacity. You have must have capable people in the public sector, because if you complain about regulation, well, if you don't have someone in the regulatory capacity who understands technology, understands the changes, and is able to then make smart decisions on how to formulate regulation, then you're going to have problems. So I think investing in public sector capacity is just as important, making sure you get a fair share of talent there. That's been one of our core policy positions.
We've got just over a minute left. I was going to ask each of the panelists as a final question to say where in this sort of economy we've discussed going forward, this one where there's some stagnation but prospects of growth in the emerging world and with new technologies, as David outlined, but with ramifications longer term for different jobs, where they would want to invest their money. Manny, I know you're on the bond side, but in terms of equities, where do you see which sector do you see the greatest growth?
I would go broadly into emerging market equity, to make a short answer.
That sets you up very well, Minister.
Yep, I mean, if you want to take a geographic cut, that would be one way, but of course it goes with risk as well. But I would say even in some of the slower growth markets, there are sectors and companies within those sectors, which is where I think the skill sets come in, where you can invest and get returns. But in aggregate, I would say yes, I would hitch my wagon to the emerging higher growth markets.
Julia, you there?
Agro industry. I'll go with a different voice. There's no question that there are a lot of people on the planet who are going to need to be fed. we're going to need to do it with fewer resources in a more sustainable way. And I think it brings you to emerging economies in general, where most of the food is grown, or a lot of food is grown, and where incorporating new technology will make a big difference.
David, what about you?
Latin America was a huge grower for us, but it took a big turn. Argentina has made the turn. It's doing better. Colombia, Chile, Mexico and Brazil. Mexico has held up, even though it's had a really tough year. We're still hoping that Latin America can turn. We have a big presence down there, and if Brazil can get it going, Latin America could be a big engine for us again.
Good. I'd like to thank all four of the panelists very much. We've ended exactly on time. Thank you very much.